Good morning. If you are able, would you please stand? I've got a friend. Closer than a brother, there is no judgment. Oh, how he loves me. I've got a friend, and he is my strength. He is my portion. With me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. His mercy is enough. His grace is sufficient. So come if you're needing forgiveness or healing. His mercy is enough. Oh, and this is our hope. The cross, it is spoken. Death is no more.
Let us pray. Dear Lord of Heaven, merciful one, Thank you for taking care of us through another week. Lord, help us. Especially the one who looks after their children. There's teachers, principals, world leaders, preschool directors, all the children, Lord. Lord, and put a healing touch on the ones who are sick and shut in. Donna Nees Fawn, Lynn's sister, Richard, my son-in-law, God, who's back in the hospital. Place a roof over the head of the homeless. Feed the ones who are hungry, O God. Clothe the naked. Please release the innocent prisoners and the ones who confess of their sins. And come, we thank you again, Lord, for all you're doing and all you're going to do, Lord. And everything we ask is in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and if it's your will, let it be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we have welcome and announcement by Debbie.
Good morning, Ocoee Oaks family. As I was doing my devotions this week, I have a verse. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. For through me, the Lord, your days will be many, and your years will be added to your life. Proverbs 9, 10, and 11. If you are new to Ocoee Oaks, we want to let you know that Ocoee Oaks is an amazing and loving church led by the Holy Spirit through the congregation. The Spirit of the Lord is moving at Ocoee Oaks, and we are excited to share this with you. Our highlighted announcements for today are, we are looking for a few more volunteers to help us with our welcome and leading the chat on our live stream. If interested, please reach out to Pastor Don or Charla in the church office. And if you are interested in becoming a member of Ocoee Oaks, please see Pastor Don as we are looking at starting up our next class this summer. Ladies Night Out is tomorrow night, 6:30 at Olive Garden on 50. All ladies are welcome. And don't forget to call or email Charla to let her know which fellowship group you would like to join. The classes will begin four to six times. Here are the options. Book study, Experiencing God's Presence, led by Colleen Healy, meets right after the service starting next Sunday. What Matters Most, Living in Our Priorities, led by Pastor Don, and meeting at 8:15 in the morning. Don't forget to get up early before the service. Starting next Sunday, Bible Basics, led by Tracy Walker, meets right after the service starting next Sunday. And now please stand if you are able as Wendy leads us in opening hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. And now please join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Then she shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. And now, if you'll bow your heads for the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now please stand if you are able as we join our voices in praise, singing hymn of adoration in the garden and the song of praise, Good, Good Father.
Thank you.
stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are.
And now for this morning's scripture, Luke 15:11-24. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found.' So they began to celebrate." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now may our hearts be prepared to receive this week's message by Tracy Walker entitled "The Father's Unshakable Bond."
Thanks, Deb. Good morning.
Good morning.
Stay with me. Lord, take my voice and speak through me. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you, Lord Jesus. Amen. So it is Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to my fellow fathers out there. And I was thinking about it as I was preparing. We celebrate Father's Day a little bit differently than we do Mother's Day. And we treat fathers just a little bit different than moms. And that's okay, because we know that the dads serve different roles than moms do. And that's been my experience. I have two kids that I have been privileged to raise with their mother. And what I've learned over the course of 29-ish years is that I have a different sort of relationship with each. My son, my oldest, we've had an interesting relationship throughout the years. And what I can always count on is he will always come to me when he needs practical advice, support, or money. When he has good news to share, he's got a new girlfriend, he's getting ready to get married, he's all these happy things, straight to mom. Kendall, who you all know, Kendall is a daddy's girl, and that's just fine with me. And that's been our relationship. We've always, that's always been the relationship that we've had. And so we're grateful that dads have their special places in our lives. And I mean, after all, dads own an entire category of jokes. The dad joke, right? The puns and the groaners that are uniquely dad. Which days are the strongest? Saturday and Sunday. The rest are weekdays. Ooh. Thank you. I a rim shot. I hate it when people say age is only a number. Age is clearly a word. Oh, okay, I'll stop there. And now they'll clap because I stopped. And on top of dad jokes, we have dadisms. These little words of tidbits of advice and observation, and they're presented at just the right time and in just the right situation. When talking about finances or spending matters, do I look like I'm made of money? Does every light in this house have to be on? Are we trying to air condition the whole neighborhood? Anyone ever heard that come from a dad? Sadly, I've uttered them. Dads are also good at offering practical tips. I love this one. If it moves and it's not supposed to, duct tape. If it doesn't move and it's supposed to, WD-40. And we could go on and on. Dads have great opinions on rules and behavior, usually having to do with what one is wearing or the length of hair. But we love you, dads, and we're grateful for all you do. So let's turn to our scripture for today. This is the parable of the prodigal son. If there were a greatest hits of Bible stories, this one would probably make the list. It would probably be near the top. Even non-Christians know the basic premise if you ask them about the story of the prodigal son. So the setting is we have a father, and the father has two sons. And even though Jesus doesn't specifically say, we know the family probably has some wealth, and we can probably infer that they're better off than most. They have property, they have servants, they're doing pretty well for themselves. And the basic plot line goes something like this. The younger son asks for his inheritance early. The father agrees. The younger son cashes in said inheritance and goes to another country where he squanders the wealth. Now the country where the younger son is falls into famine, and now, broke, he's forced to take a job feeding pigs. Ultimately, the younger son comes to his senses and decides to return home. And he returns home in hopes that his father will at least accept him as a servant. The father sees the younger son in the distance and runs to meet him. The father lavishes his younger son with grace. Now, if you're familiar with the story, you'll know that we stopped short because there's a second son, there's an older son. But we'll save that one for another time. In and of itself, this is a very powerful story about poor choices and about redemption. But if you really sit down and study it closely, there's a cultural context that we need to consider. So in Jesus' time, when this parable was told, people held family honor in the highest esteem, and sons were expected to honor their father and respectably carry on the name, carry on the lineage. The family's honor rested on the son's shoulders, and each son had an obligation to continue the family legacy respectably. The father's inheritance usually would have been distributed to the sons after he passed. And in a case where there were two sons, such as in the parable, generally speaking, the older son would receive about 2/3 share, and the younger son would receive the remaining third. Okay? To ask for his inheritance while his father was still alive, for him to walk up to his father and say, "Father, give me my inheritance now," was akin to saying, "Dad, I wish you were dead." It just wasn't done. And then, to take it a step further, to go out and sell the inheritance and pocket the money was a further disrespect of the father. And even though the father had given the inheritance early, he would have still been entitled to profits associated with those shares of the land. And so by going out and actually selling that to somebody else, now the son has also taken money out of his father's pocket, all for selfish gain. Yet despite this disrespect, the father never wavers on his willingness to give his younger son what was asked. We never hear the father say a discouraging word to the son. Even when the son packs it all up, put cash in hand, says, I'm headed out, I'm going to have fun, we never hear from the father discouraging that behavior. Now, there's no question that Jesus intentionally told the story in this way with this cultural context because he was trying to drive home a specific point. The Jewish people who would have been listening to this parable, especially the religious leaders, would have understood just how heinous the son's actions were. The son would have been viewed as a sinner, unworthy of any redemption. Clearly, the son had violated the third commandment. If we look in Exodus chapter 20, verse 12, honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Honor your father and mother. The son, in this case, clearly was not doing any honoring. And it goes even further than that in the cultural view. By taking a job feeding the pigs, the son would have been considered unclean under the law. Pigs were deemed unclean. To go out and actually slop around with them, it was unheard of. All of these actions of this younger son would have incensed the religious leaders who believed the law was central to a relationship with God. You've heard the term legalism. The law was everything. Given the level of disrespect and disregard for Jewish cultural norms, we definitely wouldn't have expected what happens when the son returns. So the son, he's desperate, he's humiliated, but he still chooses to return home in hopes that despite his rebellion, despite his disobedience, he can at least become one of his father's servants. And when the father sees the son coming home, he did the unthinkable. He ran to meet his son while the son was still at a great distance. And when the father reached his son, he was so overjoyed at the son's return that the father kissed him and gave him three items of significance. The father gave him the best robe, which was only given to an honored guest. The father gave him a ring, and the ring symbolized authority, and it signified the youngest son had been restored his place in the family just by coming home, just by the father's grace. The father also placed sandals on the son's feet. And this was significant because servants did not wear sandals, only people of honor. The son came back expecting to be made a servant, a slave to his father, and his father said, no, no, you are my son. And in addition to the items that the father gave, he commanded that the fatted calf be killed, and that was only reserved for special occasions. So even after being disrespected, the father extends what can only be described as radical grace. The son didn't deserve it, but the father gave it. Now the lesson of this story has many layers, and we can view each of those layers from the different perspectives of the characters. The younger son disrespects his father, is irresponsible with wealth, and ultimately realizes the errors of his way and returns home a more humble man. The father gives the disrespectful younger son his inheritance early without any resistance, and despite the son's foolish ways, the father extends grace when his son returns. So perhaps the better title for this parable would be The Lost Son and the Prodigal Father. You see, the definition of prodigal is a little confusing, because words such as wastefulness and carelessness are used in conjunction with prodigal, and that's usually as it relates to money. When you're called a prodigal, it means that you're wasteful and you're careless. But prodigal also means extravagant and lavish. What the father did was extravagant grace. He lavished on his son. The father's grace to his repentant younger son is definitely extravagant. And I don't know about you, but when I think about the story of the prodigal son, I think primarily about how the son was lost and then found. The father says so himself. We focus on this young man who goes off to a foreign country and he wastes away all of this money, and we can think back to, oh boy, I can think of times I did that. We celebrate that the foolish and disrespectful young man manages to figure it out, to understand the errors of his way. But you wouldn't have the story if you didn't have a father who extended radical grace to the son who so disrespected him and who was so irresponsible. You can't have the lost son without the prodigal father. See, and we didn't really even talk about the older son and his part of the story, and that's probably a separate study for another time, but the father extends radical grace to that son as well, because that son becomes jealous over how this foolhardy brother of his went off, did all these terrible things, and yet he's welcomed back like nothing happened. Come on. This father is a godly man. The biblical role of fathers and other godly men hasn't changed over the millennia. A godly father is expected to mirror the love and grace shown by our Heavenly Father, even to those who are so disobedient that it takes everything in their power to look past the sin and the disrespect. A godly father is expected to extend unconditional love so that each child knows they are loved and cared for and that they have purpose. A godly father protects their family, and that doesn't mean just physical protection. It means protecting emotionally and spiritually. A godly father is willing to make any kind of sacrifice for others, so that he can provide a role model for doing what is right and just. We've talked a lot about loving God and loving people the last few weeks. And as Pastor Don said last week, that's our battle cry. That's a Coey Oaks battle cry when we go into the mission field. Love God, love people. A godly father extends the love that Paul, the Apostle Paul, described in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, it always perseveres. And our Heavenly Father is giving us many examples of unshakable bonds with his people. The fall of Adam and Eve, instead of dismissing them and ending humanity, he clothed them and gave them a second chance. King David committed adultery, had Bathsheba's husband killed, and yet God forgave him and called him a man after his own heart. Jonah tried to run away. He showed disobedience by running away from God's calling. And yet God spared his life and gave him a second chance. Peter, the Apostle Peter, was a man with many blunders and many flaws, yet God waited until Peter was mature and used him mightily. And the Apostle Paul, as a tax collector, he persecuted the early church and was responsible for injuring many and imprisoning others, and yet the Lord changed him and he went on to plant churches and write nearly half the Bible. A few weeks ago, we celebrated Mother's Day. And our youth, as they always do, did a great job of leading worship. We are so fortunate to have a talented group of youth. Isabel brought the message that week, and in that message, she made a really good point that stuck with me. And she said that someone doesn't have to be a biological mother to share a motherly influence. It could be an aunt, a friend, a teacher. I think the same can be said on Father's Day. If you aren't a biological father, but maybe a stepfather, an uncle, a mentor, or just a friend, you have the opportunity to extend a father's unshakable bond as a man of God. In February 2005, I was a lost son. I was a lost father. I was a lost friend. I was in the grips of alcohol addiction. I had disrespected my wife, my family, my children, and everyone else who was close to me. I'd reached such a low point in my life that I was convinced that recovery wasn't even possible. But there was a group of godly men, my father included, who thought I was worth saving. They intervened despite the disrespect I showed them. They put aside all of the terrible things that I had done to them and to others. And they extended such grace and a little tough love that I saw a way out. They were willing to love me and pick me up even though I had acted foolishly. I was lost, but was ultimately found again. Each year on February 21st, when I reflect on another year of sobriety, I remember the unshakable bond of my father and other godly men who extended such radical grace to a lost son. And I'm forever indebted. How great is the love of the Father and the unshakable bond of grace and mercy that we can all be called the children of God. Amen.
Dear Father, thank you for the word from Tracy that says unshakable bond. Thank you that when we make mistakes, that you are there to forgive us, even in our poor choices, especially when we squander what you gave us, Lord. We know we do not deserve anything, but you grant us mercy and grace through all that we go through. And we thank you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. pour out. Okay, thank you. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. It's on, but my glasses is not. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. I'm not using this because I can't handle both. But my mouth is big. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, this is my blood of the new covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Your cup. Body of Christ and blood of Jesus. Brain is not working too good today. Amen. Amen. The altar is open. He loves you. Come and tell him how much you love him. Jesus. If you're able, and join us in singing the closing song, "Who You Say I Am."
lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Oh, the sun sets free. Oh, he's free. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me.
I'll not be with you for 2 weeks. I'll be gone. So just keep me in your prayer, my family. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance in you and give you peace, both now and forever. Let all God's children say, Amen. Amen.